Shalom and welcome to Jerusalem Studio. With the international community relatively united in its efforts to battle global Islamic terrorism, even though the identity of those organizations may differ from one state to another, the growing pressure on Islamists bolsters their efforts to commit acts of terror around the world. To discuss this topic, I'm joined here in the studio by Colonel in Reserve Dr. Reuven Berko, who is a columnist at the Yisrael Hayom Daily. Welcome. I'd like also to welcome our TV7 analyst, Mr. Amir Oren, and Dr. Eran Lerman, who is a senior research associate at the Begin-Sadat Center for Strategic Studies at the Shalem Academic Center. Welcome. Mr. Oren, give us a broader understanding of the situation.
A quarter century ago, so we had the famous debate between two scholars, Fukuyama and Huntington, regarding the question whether we have reached the end of history, or is it a clash of civilization? The latter by Huntington seems to be more accurate now because we see two great waves hitting each other. One is the Islamization or the radical Islam, which of course has nuances and has streams within it, but nevertheless, there is a great wave of Islamism. And on the other side, a counter wave of what the West, the right wing in the West, perhaps the national or nationalistic strain in the West is doing. And as we are speaking now, this particular year, 2017, seems to be the clash between these two opposing waves, with the West seeming to have the upper hand, but we have not heard the last of the radical Islam, because even after the great battles over Mosul in Iraq and Raqqa in Syria are over, with Daesh, ISIS, having been defeated, we are still going to see the terrorist repercussions of this great battle.
Dr. Belko, we see terror attacks in Sweden and in Russia and Egypt and Israel and so many different places and countries that all have some kind of bonds between them that you can pretty much identify in the theology or the radicalization of Islamic aspirations to the core of this theology. Give us an understanding. Is this truly linked, or is it individual organizations or individual people who finds it as a divine calling in order to act, in order to receive the upper hand?
Well, since Amir spoke about history and end of wars, and with an historical view about the subject you've raised, we just have to look at the ideology of Muslim Brothers to understand that this is actually a permanent war against the West, against all infidels in the world, as Islam or radical Islamism sees it. And I see a great change in the view of the West by understanding and stop speaking in a very political way and identifying the idea. This is not versions of a problem that cannot be defined. Once you understand the operational code of radical Islamism, you understand them all. And if you follow the history of the activists in any of these movements, from Al-Qaeda through ISIS, going to Muslim Brothers, to Hamas, to Islamic Jihad, you find the same heroes taking from the milestones of Said Qutb, Hassan al-Banna, and other doctrinaires who has established the idea of achieving Islamic goals by whether they say it by temptations or convincing people or by forcing them to get Islam as the ruling system of the world. This is a permanent battle between Islam and the way they imitate or they want to imitate the lessons of the Prophet by forcing others to get Islam. That's what you see in any of these Islamic movements.
Dr. Lerman?
Well, I have a different opinion. First of all, I spent much of my adult life in and out of uniform telling people that the Huntington thesis is erudite, brilliant, fascinating, and dead wrong. He's looking in the wrong direction. He looked at the collapse of Yugoslavia, specifically of Bosnia, going in three different directions, and he drew a huge picture out of one case. The problem is not Islam against the West. I would go with Emmanuel Sivan, who said a clash within Islamic civilization. And my point is this. Hassan al-Banna and Said Qutb, and even more influential, Maulana Maududi, the Indian and later Pakistani thinker, who's the most clear-minded and most, I would say, organized thinker of the three of them. All of them have borrowed very heavily from modern totalitarian political theory. I think we don't say Islamofascists because we don't want to sound, you know, insulting. But this is a marriage between the ideas of fascism, also Bolshevism, the totalitarian systems, and elements of Islam. It's very important for us to draw this distinction because I was looking at this bloodbath in Tanta and Alexandria. Sisi, on the 1st of January 15, launched a battle which is not just a military and intelligence battle, which, of course, we all need to stand with and support, but also what he called Tashkhikh al-Khitab Dini, the reform of the religious discourse. Mm-hmm. In other words, he says for 200 years, that's probably, the Saudis probably did not take kindly to that because that probably hints at the Wahhabi problem. But he said, for 200 years, we've gone off course. Islam has been hijacked by a system of ideas that is essentially, certainly with the Brotherhood, a modern version, I would say, perversion of religion. So we have to stand with Sisi in his efforts to fight this from within Islam, because the ultimate ally against this phenomenon are other Muslims.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Oren.
You have a triple matrix here. This is going to be simplistic, but just in order to illustrate. You have the first matrix, which is Sunni versus Shia. The other matrix, again, simplistic, moderate versus radical. And then you have the question of pan-Islamism, one big ummah or one khalif who is the commander-in-chief of all the believers, versus the national strain which you have in various countries, even though they may adhere to one of the metrics which I pointed out. And so you have a clash on three fronts simultaneously, and this causes the chaos which we see even before other forces, such as adjacent countries, Israel, for instance, or world powers, before they come in, you have this chaos within the Muslim world.
Nevertheless, what we hear from Dr. Lerman is, in order to exercise some kind of true change within Muslim society, we should use the moderates who try and fight with the radical Islamic organizations, but are those moderates actually truly believing in combating this ideology, or is it their way of, excuse my language, but sucking up to the West?
Well, it's very hard to define moderate in what we see in Islam today. What we are suffering from is very clear and obvious. What we suffer from, Islamic organizations that claim to carry the tradition and the heritage of Islam, and that's what you see. Theoretically, there are a lot of millions of people who call themselves Muslim, but they do not commit suicide and hurt others and kill innocent people in the streets of Europe and even in our region. So the question what Maududi has preached, or Afghani, or Said Qutb, this is the main idea that causes this stream of blood that we see in the streets. We can speak about the 1.4 million of Muslims that call themselves Muslim and do not hurt anybody. But we are bothered of those millions who do kill innocent people in the name of Allah and make what they call takfir, which is they find even Muslims who are not behaving the way they expect them to, They are infidels in their eyes. Mm-hmm. So the subject is not theoretically who are moderates. We have to fight, we have to identify that those who carry the name of Allah and the heritage of Muhammad and kill innocent people are the enemy. And this is the first number one achievement that the West can do. Stop saying there are other Muslims, moderate Muslims. It's hyulik. It's something that you cannot... You cannot touch. And this misleads people to think that we have somebody to do business with. There are nobody except for Sisi. He doesn't consider himself in the first place a Muslim in any of these streams. He, of course, is a Muslim, but he does not go under definition of Egypt as an Islamic state. I mean to emphasize in this point that running for definition of moderate Muslims under the flag of Islam, you cannot find those people. They are states by their own, and they are looking for solutions.
As Mr. Oren said, that there's a aspect to things, and also an Islamic aspect to things. I'll give you a chance.
But the movements are the enemy. Those movements are Muslim brother, are the babies of the Muslim brother movement, and this is something very, very clear to identify and to fight against.
Dr. Lerman.
Just very quickly, I think we need to be very clear about who the enemy is, and it is not in our interest to turn every Muslim into an enemy. A number of years ago, the late President Wahid of Indonesia was not easy to listen to. He had emphysema. His speech was difficult to listen, but once you heard what he said, it was very impressive. And he was speaking to a Jewish audience in America, saying these people represent something that I cannot identify with as a Muslim. And he was the leader of the largest Muslim nation on earth, 300 million. And so we need to be very careful not to corner ourselves into a clash of civilizations with Islam as such. Moreover, if you define this as modern totalitarianism, we have seen the death of the black version of totalitarianism and the red version of totalitarianism. And I believe we'll see the burial of the green version of totalitarianism, Islamist totalitarianism. We can believe in this victory, but we have to define the enemy. The Bush administration made a mistake of calling it terrorism. Terrorism is a horror, but it's a tool, it's a weapon.
And so Obama ignored it totally.
And Obama called what he was doing CVE. Countering violent extremism. It sounded like a social workers project in a poor suburb. I think the real language we should use, I call it DIT, defeating Islamist totalitarianism, to be very clear. And the Brotherhood certainly is the mother of the rot. And here we should stand with the Egyptians.
I'd like to move further, Mr. Oren, when we're talking about the impractical means, we're talking about various organizations, whether it's the Islamic State or the Muslim Brotherhood and its various affiliations and derivations, including Hamas, which is one of them, including the Al-Qaeda organization, which also has plenty of organizations under its hood. This is just on the one hand of the spectrum, the Sunni Muslim spectrum. Then we have the Shiite Muslims with Hezbollah and Iran enforcing various organizations, including the Houthi rebels in Yemen and so on. Do we see all those organizations seeking to return to the West and really enforce its will through various methods, of course, but as Dr. Lerman identified, the one method that might touch each and every one of us at home, which is terrorism. How much of a danger is it today with so many identical attacks happening in Europe as well as in the United States?
Well, we had various forms of terrorism in the West, some of which were homegrown. Americans against the federal government and its institutions, or the Red Brigades and Baader-Meinhof. And some of them were probably organized, orchestrated by the Soviets as part of the covert war during the Cold War. So it stands to reason that, yes, we will also see a continuation of this export version of the fight between radical Islam and the West. But this doesn't seem to be the main front. Because, for instance, you mentioned Hamas. Hamas has a very curious relationship with ISIS, the neighborly part of ISIS in the Sinai.
Mm-hmm. Wilayat Sina.
Wilayat Sina. Province.
Nevertheless,
Sinai Peninsula.
Sometimes they cooperate.
Nevertheless, Wilayat Sina, when we're talking about them specifically, they used to be part of the Muslim Brotherhood under Ansar Beit al-Maqdis.
They still
changed
are.
Their loyalties.
They are still are.
Yes, and
declared of.
And Hamas is an offshoot of the Muslim Brotherhood too. But nevertheless, Hamas has its priorities regarding the Palestinians, primarily Gaza now. Perhaps it will take over. It wants to the entire Palestinian community, and it wants to dictate to the Wilayat al-Sinai when to act and when not, according to its own interests. Now, take Hezbollah. Hezbollah had a legitimate grievance as the protector of the oppressed Shiites in Lebanon. The Shiites were the biggest minority, the biggest group, but nevertheless, because of some political arrangement, the Maronites and then the Sunnis held most of the political cards, and they were relegated to third place. So when the Iranian Revolution took place, they connected with Hezbollah. So Hezbollah also acts in methods which we call terrorism, but it also has a legitimate political base to act from and some political rights which they are trying to protect. So we cannot put all of the Muslim organizations in one basket.
Doctor?
Well, I believe that, and continuing your idea, mentioning Hezbollah on the one hand and Hamas on the other side, on the other hand, we almost forgot the fact that there are states who this organization belonged to as proxies. And by pointing on Hezbollah or Hamas or ISIS or Al-Qaeda or others, we should not forget states like Qatar, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, who for a long time supported this organization. Some of them still support them beyond the cartoon. So this is a very important way first, to put the finger on those states who still encourage this and support them by money and training and ammunition and arm, etc. And this is part of the way to get ahead in fighting the phenomena by understanding that we still face proxies. For example, Hezbollah belongs to Iran. Iran runs this under the service of the idea of exploring Shiite, Madhab, Shiite section in the world. On the other hand, the Sunnis run the show of the Sunnah radical terrorist organization against them, against the world. So this is a very complicated puzzle, but on the way to gain some achievements against these two branches of radical Islamism, Shia and Sunnah, we have to also to recognize that there are still countries that support this movement.
I'd like to touch on something very interesting that happened last week when the referendum happened in Turkey.
Yes.
We had President Recep Tayyip Erdogan come in front of his followers and actually declare that the West, who he defined as the Crusaders, have lost, and their supporters in Turkey have lost as well. So he will march on and make Turkey strong and Islamic and so on and so forth. But he used the terminology Crusaders. The same thing happened when the Bush administration at the time, President Bush, when the operation happened in Afghanistan, the first terminology he used was Crusaders as well. The Crusades in Afghanistan, if I'm not mistaken.
There was an American officer who used the term Bush.
Bush did.
Bush also did, but one just to put it into context,
please.
General Eisenhower, when he commanded all of the coalition forces, the Allied forces against Hitler, called it crusade in Europe.
It doesn't matter. The fact is that Muslims use this term against the West.
Bush afterwards made every effort, because that was the neoconservative position. Islam is reformable, and he wanted to work with Islamic allies.
Well, he tried to. Nevertheless, Dr. Lerman, when we're talking about this terminology,
yes,
does this initiate some kind of effect within the Muslim world to try and move forward and attack the West and attack Christians and attack the whole Western faith and ideology compared to the Islamic?
Well, where Erdogan will go now is, I think, a very, very significant question. It's not easy to predict because he's basically trying to undermine the legitimacy of 48.6% of Turkish voters. That's if you believe the outcome. It's a society split right down the middle. He, if he wants to take it any further in his direction, he's going to find himself in a very difficult situation at the urban centers of Turkey. In Istanbul, Ankara, Izmir all voted significantly against it. It's not easy to take a society that far, of course. He's done a remarkable job, but he has done it because he's been able to keep the Turkish economy rising in conjunction, in a kind of relationship with the West. If he takes it to a place of conflict, he will destroy the foundations on which the political achievements of the AKP were based in the last 12 years.
Nevertheless, Dr. Berko, I want to touch base specifically on the wording that he used. The fact that of the matter is he did use the word a crusade or crusaders of the West trying to influence what is happening in an Islamic country. Mr. Oren, I'll give you a chance, Dr. Berko, in a minute. Can you touch base on that specifically? Will that influence so many people or Muslims living in Europe, living in the United States, in Australia, and other Western countries which are defined as Christian and push them in order to act in a terroristic way?
Whether it will push them to do it or whether it reflects a tendency remains to be seen. But the figures which Dr. Lerman mentioned are approximately the same figures which we saw in the Brexit vote and in the Hillary Clinton versus Donald Trump vote. Only Hillary Clinton got the majority, didn't help her, of course. Now, the Turks and Erdogan specifically are frustrated by the way they were treated by Europe, by the European Union. And of course, part of the real reason, not the declared reason, but the real reason the European Union did not absorb Turkey and did not give it an equal status was because it was going to become the most populous member of the European Union with most of the power which is given according to it. And because it is Muslim, the Christians in Europe, it is not nice to say it, but the Christians in Europe did not want Turkey to become a major member of their union. And because Turkey was rejected, of course, it also bolstered those feelings which you talked about. But to my mind, the question
I don't think that only the Christians wanted that to refrain from that situation, though.
Perhaps, yes. But you know, if you go around places in Germany, such as Berlin, you see enclaves of second and third generation Turks whose fathers and grandfathers wanted to assimilate, but they do not. They are not acting in any terrorist way, but they do not want to become German now. They are the offspring of workers, of Gastarbeiters who were brought to Germany because of labor shortage, but they want to keep their heritage. But the real question, to my mind, the real question is, you know, in Israel, we are talking about the Jewish and democratic nature of the country, and we are asking ourselves, can they be in conflict? The question regarding separation of church and state in the Muslim countries is, can there be a Muslim democratic country?
Dr. Berko.
Well, I would emphasize the word you used, which Erdogan used it himself, crusaders. This is a very important word to understand where radical Islamism is going to, because Erdogan himself was a graduate of Muslim Brotherhood movement. And this is a very important milestone in this idea of radical Islamism. Crusaders are connected to the heritage of Islam and the way the Muslims defeated Byzantion, which was the eastern part of the Christian Empire, and instead what is at that day considered to be the Vatican of the Eastern churches, is now a mosque. And later on, 11th century, Salah ad-Din al-Ayyubi has managed to throw away the Crusaders. So these are symbols. When using this keyword, Crusaders, this is a state of mind. This is a very critical way through which they considered each one of the Christian regimes in Europe an enemy, as it was the days of Byzantion and Caesar Heraclius, who was defeated by Islam, and later on Salah ad-Din, who defeated the Christians as well. All those people now are called Crusaders, and this symbolizes the fact that Islam treats Christian world as Crusaders, as an enemy.
Dr. Lerman?
Well, as I said, it depends where Turkey goes. There is a danger that Erdogan will feel now that he has essentially
back to power, vindicated
the mandate,
and he has a mandate. But that's a questionable proposition, given the fact that his power rests at the end of the day on a system that does cooperate with the West. If he goes in the direction of really
Ottoman Empire,
resurrecting the Ottoman Empire, that's not exactly going to work. And Europe has ways of making this very difficult. Mm-hmm. Whether NATO can continue to treat Turkey in the long run as a legitimate member, there's no procedure in NATO for throwing a member out. But, procedures can be invented as you go along if a member becomes ideologically completely disconnected. Now, for Turkey to be left without the NATO umbrella in the neighborhood in which Turkey lives, not a very good idea from a Turkish point of view. So I think there are, restraints on his ability to take this to this logic of crusading. One interesting story.
We're coming actually to the end of
history,
the program.
You have in Europe a Turkish expatriate party. In the Dutch elections, they broke out of the socialists because they supported the Kurds. Mm-hmm. And there's now Turkish members of parliament in the Netherlands who were elected as Turks.
That is correct, actually, but we're coming to the end of the program. So, Mr. Oren, last sentence.
Just to remind ourselves that Erdogan's arch enemy is a Muslim cleric, Gulen, who happens to live in the United States.
This is all the time that we have for today, so I'd like to thank Dr. Reuven Berko for coming here, Mr. Amir Oren, and Dr. Eran Lerman. Thank you so very much. I'd like to thank our viewers as well, and we will see you next time. TV7 Israel's mission is to give you, our viewers, truthful information, which in effect will give you a chance to really understand what is happening in Israel and its region. If you are blessed by our programs and believe our mission to be important, we urge you to support us and become a voice for Israel. You can support us by going to our website at tv7israelnews.com. This program was made possible through your donations.